morning, church. Let's just worship this morning and declare that we serve a great God. Amen.
Come, let us worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great.
Faithful. Let's sing this together.
You've been faithful through every storm, and you'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again, for your promise is yes and amen. You will do great. God, you do great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave. You free every captive, break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Jesus, our Savior, your name.
Time of communion and this time of worship, I want us to look at what communion means to us from a biblical standpoint, but also how it relates to us today. And so I want to read Matthew chapter 26, verses 26 through 29. And it says this: Now as they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and after blessing it, broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, for this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of this fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you. And I want us to think about this as we look around us, as we see the chaos in the world around us. But we have peace. Peace knowing that we have a God that went to the cross for us, that died for us, that broke his body and shed his blood so that we could be forgiven, so that we could have a relationship with him. So Jesus doesn't say, do this in remembrance of me when it's good and when everything's going great. Do this in remembrance when things are bad. No, he just says, do this in remembrance of me. We get to share that love that Christ showed us through dying on the cross. And we get to remember that today. We get to remember that we have a God who is great, that died on the cross for us and rose again. So let's remember that today. Let's remember that his death on the cross and resurrection means new life for us. And this is our chance to thank him, to respond and worship by saying, God, thank you. And in the midst of the chaos, we want to take time to put you first and to remember what you did on the cross for us. So I'm going to take this bread, and this represents the body that was broken for us. And let's take and eat in remembrance of Christ. And also he said to take the juice and to drink as a symbol of his blood that was poured out for us. So let's take and drink in remembrance of him.
see him, we know he's working. Let's sing this together. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, you never stop working. Never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. Never stop, never stop working. Never stop, never stop. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Singing, that is who you are. That is who you are. That is who you are, God. That is who you are. Amen. As a church, let's just declare this one more time. Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are. Miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness. My God, that is who you are.
Good morning, Jeff Street. Well, instead of meeting in person on this first Sunday of 2021, we again find ourselves worshiping online. Now, we've made this decision from a place of precaution and safety, and hopefully, if there are no other issues, we will be meeting again in person next Sunday, January 10th. Now, with that said, I just simply want to encourage everyone to be checking your emails, to look at our webpage, and also check us out on Facebook just for any updates or any information that we might have. I also want to remind everyone that you can give online at our webpage. Go to jeffstreet.org/give and just simply follow the prompts to make your contribution, and thank you for your faithful and generous giving. Now, in regard to starting our Core 52 book this morning, let me just say this, that I'm encouraging everyone to read the chapter, in today's case, chapter 42, before each Sunday message. Now, if you've done that for today's message, great. If not, no worries. You can go back and read it later. But then after reading the chapter, what I'm asking is that you just kind of follow Mark Moore's suggestions with his 5-day, I guess the best word I can use is assignments, Monday through Friday, to follow along completely with the book. Which, what that will do is that will leave Saturday available for everyone to read the next chapter in preparation for next Sunday's message, which for next week is the topic of freedom. And the key verse, or the main core verse, is Romans chapter 8, verse 1, and all of that is found on page 277 of the Core 52 book. Now, this is the way that I'm suggesting that you use the book, but really, here's the key. Whatever works best for you is what I want. Now, today's chapter is on radical change. And I believe that's an appropriate topic as we start a new year. And the key verse is Romans chapter 12, verse 2. Now, I want to read that verse, but I also want to include verse 1 for a very particular reason. And for today, I'm going to be reading from the 1984 translation of the NIV, okay? That translation says this: "Therefore, I urge you, brothers, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, His good, pleasing, and perfect will. When William Booth, the founder of Salvation Army, was asked to explain the impact of his life, why it was that he, a person of basic and simple means, was used in such a remarkable way, he replied with these words, "Jesus Christ has all of me." This morning, as we begin talking about change at the beginning of a brand new year, I want us to think about what it might mean for Jesus Christ to have all of us. Now, in talking about change, I think it's helpful to remember that there are those individuals who are resistant to change. Many, due to pride, fear of the unknown, an unwillingness to learn, and literally the list goes on and on and on. There are many who are comfortable with remaining the same, with making no changes in life or to their routines. Perhaps this is why the quote, I love this, I read a quote the other day that says, "Everybody wants to change the world, but nobody wants to change." I think that is so very true. Well, as chapter 42 of our book highlights for us, the Bible promises us that real change is possible. It is within our grasp, that is, with God's help. Which is why I want to begin our discussion on change and transformation at verse 1 of Romans 12. Now notice what Paul says. Paul said in Romans 12, 1, these words, "Therefore, I urge you." And what I want us to see in this one verse is this, that Paul is not commanding the Romans, nor is Paul making a suggestion by saying, "Hey, I have a couple of ideas I want you all to think about." He also isn't heavy-handed with them. He doesn't write and say, "You Romans will do this, or you're going to experience my wrath when I arrive in Rome." No, instead what Paul does is Paul plays the role of quarterback. He tries to rally everyone with a sense of urgency. He's a leader making a plea, and what we need to remember is this plea has a very strong desire. And he makes this plea on the basis of God's mercy. "Therefore, I urge you in view of God's mercy." Now, the word "therefore" is also a very important word. When we come to Romans 12, Paul begins making a shift. And the shift that he's making is from, I would say, from doctrine to more practical application. And that's important because theology should always be practical and applicable to our lives. And theology is applicable to all areas of our life. And so it's as if Paul is saying, based on everything that I've just said, here is what I'm strongly urging you, Romans, to put into practice. Now, many scholars acknowledge that the word "therefore" is really, I would say, encapsulating everything that Paul has already said from Romans chapter 1 to Romans chapter 11. And starting in Romans chapter 1, Paul has been laying down a foundation, a foundational need of God's mercy in light of our sinfulness. So in other words, kind of this idea that if we really desire to be put back into a right relationship with God, if we really desire to make things right between us and the Lord, then God's mercy is key. And even though Paul could have used a command here in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, he instead does what he did in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1. Paul said this, "I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received." Paul wanted the Romans, and to a very large extent, us, to understand just how deep sin has affected us. That there is not a part of us that sin has not touched. Sin affects our minds and the way we think. Sin affects our emotions and the way we expend them. And this is why Paul said in Romans chapter 3, verse 10, and also in verse 23, there is no one righteous, not even one. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. In other words, what Paul has been saying is this. We have a natural bent away from God because of sin. And it's not just that we have a natural bent because of sin. We have no way of helping ourselves, which is why Paul issues a call to the followers of Jesus in Rome to commit themselves 100%, mind, body, spirit, to Jesus Christ. And he makes that plea on the basis of what? He makes the plea on the basis of mercy, not God's grace, his mercy. Paul is saying, you know, to us, you good folk at Jeff Street, you were once like this. You used to live like this. You used to think a certain way. But God has changed all of that in and through Jesus Christ. God came to us in Jesus and saved us. And Paul reminds us in Titus chapter 3, verse 5, not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. And so we need to understand God's grace. God's grace is giving to us what we don't deserve. God's mercy is about God not giving to us what we do deserve. Now, you might be wondering, why in the world am I rambling on about all of this stuff? Well, for starters, I would say this. Paul goes to great lengths to lay out not only our condition, the fact that we are sinful through and through, but Romans chapter 1, even through Romans chapter 12, he also lays out and shares with us our only solution is Jesus. And what we need to remember is Paul is writing to people who have actually surrendered their lives to this good news. That's at the heart of his plea, in view of God's mercy. That if you are a follower of Jesus and believe that he went to the cross on your behalf, that he took the punishment that you deserve and provided the forgiveness that you don't deserve, the plea is to live and become all that God intends for you and for me to be. Now, I really do not care whatever word we want to use as we talk about this first series in Your Best You. You can use whatever word you want, changed, transformed. You can use the word made different. You can use the word renewal. What Paul is stressing is the need to be converted to Christ. I love the word conversion. And here's why. Because true and lasting change is impossible without conversion to Jesus. The phrase, in view of God's mercy, will not be significant to you unless you understand the need for conversion. To understand, you know, that we are sinful. That we are sinful through and through. We have a natural bent away from God. That we are broken. But because of what he did for us, we can be fixed. We can be transformed. That is vitally important. See, if you want true and lasting change, what Paul is inferring here is this, that kind of transformation is not possible outside of being totally converted through the cross of Jesus Christ. And here's the key. If you think that is possible, that true change is possible, then one of two things is going to happen in your life. One will be this. You will quickly realize just how correct Paul is, because you will also quickly discover how often failure and setbacks will visit you in your walk. Now, if you are successful at some minor external changes that you make in your life, here's the second thing that will happen. It can turn you into a legalistic Pharisee. Going about spouting off, oh, see all the things that I have done in my life. Look, you know, everyone, at what, you know, accomplishments I have made. I love John Calvin. John Calvin once said that we will never worship with a sincere heart or serve God with unbridled zeal until we properly understand how much we are indebted to God's mercy. And so, God's grace, yes, and His mercy working in our lives, that's what transforms us from selfish individuals into selfless individuals who become more concerned to see God's kingdom advance than our own agendas built. And so really, here's the issue. The initial question this morning as we talk about change and transformation is this: can you honestly say, Jesus has all of me? Can you, in your prayer times, say to Jesus, wherever, whenever, or whatever? Because if that is what you desire, then here's where it begins. It begins with the need to be converted to Jesus Christ. But Paul also issues the call, not just to be converted to Christ, but to be connected with Christ. Paul says in verse 2 these words, "Do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." Now, I want you to notice the phrase, that two words, "any longer." That phrase is important because it's pointing out what we just talked about in this idea, or what I said, the need to be converted to Jesus. Because to be converted is to be brought into a new or a different dimension of life. When a person becomes a Christian, they not only have a new nature and perhaps a new status, but I think what Paul is driving at in Romans 12 is this, that we have a new position in the world. So, Paul says, in view of God's mercy, he's asking us to live in a different way. For individuals who have been converted, Paul is saying, you must also, just as equally, be connected with Christ. And to connect with Christ, to live in such a way that Jesus has all of you, Paul stresses surrendering to Him our mind and our bodies. I hope we understand the mind is the control tower of our bodies. What we do with our bodies is in direct relationship to what is happening right up here in our mind. With our minds, we make decisions. With our minds, we settle on our feelings. With our minds, we determine our affections. And Paul is saying, if you desire to give your entire life to Him, your mind is absolutely crucial. Which is why Paul said in Romans chapter 12, 2, these three words, do not conform. Now, I particularly like J.B. Phillips' paraphrase of Romans 12, 2. It reads this way: don't let the world around you squeeze you into its own mold, but let God remold your minds from within. See, here, Paul is urging us to stop being pushed into the fashion of the world. And I think we all understand what that means, because I think we all know and we understand that sometimes we are so conformed to the world that there is little noticeable difference between Christians and non-Christians. And here is why it matters what we watch. Here's why it matters what we read. And this is why it matters what we fill our minds with. Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 23, everything is permissible, but not everything is beneficial. And I can go down the list. I will not mention any names, but I know many believers who have hurt, who have hampered, and who have hindered their own walk with Jesus Christ as a result of allowing themselves freedoms that, while not clearly denied in Scripture have not proved helpful to them at all in their walk with Jesus. Paul says, do not conform, but be transformed. Now that word refers to an interchange. It's where we get the word metamorphosis from. We usually think of David Banner and the Incredible Hulk in this situation. A metamorphosis. Here's what Paul wants us to know. A metamorphosis is not something we can do on our own. No, this is the work of God. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. So, when a person comes to Jesus Christ and is converted, then an inner transformation takes place. The Spirit of God begins to use the Word of God in the child of God to help make us increasingly more like the Son of God. And that whole process, we need to remember, is a process. It sometimes is a slow process. Our minds are renewed by the Word of God as the Spirit of God reveals truth to us in small increments. Our lives are daily being renewed so that while we are not all that we should be, we can at least look back and see that we are not what we once used to be. And when that transformation begins to take place, when that change begins to happen, here is where you will see a congregation radically change. But when that happens, when you are converted to Jesus Christ and connected with Christ, the result of all of that is this, a deep commitment for Christ, which is all about true transformation, true change, real change. And I think it's really helpful for us to remember that our mission of bringing people to a deeper relationship with God always starts with this first step, looking into the mirror. In other words, it starts with you. It starts with me. It starts when you ask yourself, have I truly presented myself to Him in complete surrender? I hope you understand bringing people to a deeper relationship with God. It happens when you first begin with yourself and then you go through your schedule and you consider what's really important from an eternal perspective. And from that viewpoint, from that perspective, you begin to fill out your to-do list and your monthly schedule and weekly schedule. See, ask yourself, in view of God's mercy, in view of the fact that He didn't give to me what I deserve, how should I respond? Should we respond by watching TV all day? Should we respond by, you know, filling in our calendars with so much school and work and kids' sports activities that there's no time left for Him? I want us to remember, we exist to serve God. And the best way to serve Him starts when you ask, does He have all of me? And if He doesn't, then you start there and you begin to make the necessary changes in your life. Ask yourself, is He first in my life? Is Jesus first in my finances? Is He first with regard to your time and your talents? Never forget, Paul is stressing in Romans 12 that radical change requires real surrender to a remarkable Savior. So, what old habits need to go? What bad practices need to stop? What good things need to be picked up and need to be started? Radical change requires real surrender to a remarkable Savior. And since I think it is always wise and is always beneficial for the speaker to leave before the audience does, here, my friends, is where I will stop. But before I pray, let me say, Jeff Street, Happy New Year. I am so looking forward to growing together, to growing with you in 2021. Hopefully, prayerfully, we will see each other physically next week. God bless you. Let me pray. Gracious God and Father, we thank you for every example that we have in the life of those who have blazed a trail before us, who have been prepared to offer up their lives as a living sacrifice for you. Oh God, we thank you for the salvation that you offer to us in your Son, Jesus. Help us to remember that your word promises us that transformation is possible, possible only through your Son. But we ask that you help lead us to that place of surrender where we can, with zeal and confidence, say, Jesus has all of me. For these things we pray in the precious and holy name of Jesus. Amen.
Restoration in our world. Let's sing this together. We want to see hearts ablaze. We want to see people change. We want to see revival, revival. We want to see mercy win the hopeless to hope again. Amen. We want to see revival, revival. To see lives restored and evil to win no more. We want to see revival, revival. We want to see miracles. Let heaven invade this world. We want to see revival, revival. Open up the heavens. Your presence, we want to see revival. Bring us back to you. Oh, how we need you to. We want to see revival. Let's sing that together again. Open up the heavens. Pour out your presence. We want to see revival. Bring us back to you. Oh, how we need you to.
Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord and to share His gospel.
We want to see hearts ablaze. We want to see people changed. We want to see revival, revival. We want to see mercy win the hopeless to hope again. We want to see revival, revival.